Yeah, good afternoon to all who joined the pre-Congress workshop organized by the Sri Lanka Medical Association as a pre-Congress activity of the 134th Anniversary International Medical Congress on Stroke Unit Care for Clinicians. Today is the fourth lecture, the Zoom fourth lecture in this series of talks, and the last would be tomorrow and will be followed by the workshop in the morning hours in the day after tomorrow. Here in this program, there is a very comprehensive book on stroke rehabilitation published as part of this program, and there'll be hard copies printed. And the soft copy also would be available because that we are supposed to share the book with you all while the program is being conducted. We now have uploaded the book, and that you will be sent the link, access to this book from today. And that would be only for a transient period. But then once the book is published, we'll be able to let you have the book for your personal use. We are planning to have the workshop. We prefer at least a few of you, about 20 of you could be present in person at the auditorium of the Sri Lanka Medical Association on 18th morning, but the rest could join via this Zoom virtual access. The rehabilitation program, again, we initially were planning to have it at the Epilepsy Center, but now because of the prevailing situation of the country, we now have changed it to the auditorium of the Sri Lanka Medical Association. Today's presentation would be on disabilities in stroke and rehabilitation assessment that will be conducted by Dr. Gunendrika Kasturiratne. As it's known to most of you, Dr. Gunendrika Kasturiratne is the consultant rheumatologist at the National Hospital of. So let me invite Dr. Gunendrika to commence her presentation. Over to you, Gunendrika.
Good afternoon. My topic today in this post-stroke rehabilitation lecture series is disability in stroke and rehabilitation assessment. Mobility impairment is seen as a major area in post-stroke disability. Impaired mobility is commonly due to hemiparesis or hemiplegia, but it can also be due to cerebellar ataxia. Long-term, the mobility impairment is due to persistence of motor synergies or contractures or spasticity. Impaired ability to perform activities of daily living is also a major component or area of post-stroke disability. The impaired activities of daily living can be due to hemiplegia or the motor impairment, but also there are other factors which can contribute to the disability in performing activities of daily living. It could be just apraxia while having a satisfactory motor function, or it can be due to hemianopia or hemineglect, neglecting the affected part of the body, or depression or mood disorders, and also cognitive impairments can also affect the ability to perform the activities of daily living. So it's a multifactorial disability. Incontinence, mainly of urine, is also a major drawback in the independence of a person after a stroke, because having incontinence is a factor which will affect their confidence to behave in a social setting. It could be uncommonly, it could be due to damage to the micturition center as a part of the stroke, But while having normal bladder function, they can have incontinence due to mobility impairment or maybe due to cognition impairment. The ability to communicate successfully or satisfactorily is an essential component of somebody's independence. But aphasias are common after stroke and has been described or defined in different areas like expressive aphasia, receptive aphasia, or global aphasia with a mixture. They may have problems with reading, which is called dyslexia or alexia, or maybe they have difficulty in writing or agraphia. And anomic aphasia is a specific type of aphasia, and it can be part of all the other types of aphasias described above. Next is dysphagia. Dysphagia is common after stroke. A bedside swallowing assessment is a must in the initial evaluation of a person with stroke. Most of the patients will recover rapidly, but long term, they have high risk of aspiration, chest infections, nutritional issues, and dehydration, all of which may affect the independence further. There are multiple pain syndromes described in post-stroke patients. They are also affecting the independence significantly. The hemiparetic shoulder pain or shoulder stiffness is a recognized factor which can affect most of the activities of daily living. Sometimes they have painful spasticity. Some people have persistent headache. Complex regional pain syndromes or central post-stroke pain are having a different mechanism of etiology, and they are a little bit challenging to treat. Though all those pain syndromes also can be part of the post-stroke disability. Cognition impairments affecting the memory, reasoning, speech, and problem-solving skills. So mainly the cognition impairments will affect the person's functionality or the ability to perform activities of daily living. Yes, so there are various areas of disability in a post-stroke victim. So we need to quantify this disability, or in other words, we want to measure the functionality. We want to give a numerical value to the disability or functionality. We need to standardize the language used in stroke trials and also in clinical practice. And those disability assessment scales or severity assessment scales will predict the final outcome as well. There are various evaluation scales in post-stroke individuals. So those are found in literature, and some of the names may be familiar to you all. The Beck Depression Inventory, Geriatric Depression Scale, the Mini Mental State Examination, the Barthel Index, and the FIM, or the Functional Independence Measure, and also those quality of life scales. So how do we classify all those disability scales? What are the indications of each of those assessment scales, and what are the appropriate areas of assessment using those disability scales? International Classification of Functioning Disability and Health, the WHO-ICF, is a framework that will aid the classification of disability assessment scales. It helps to decide on an appropriate measure or scale for a particular purpose. This is a global instrument. It provides a unified and standard language. The ICF is based on the biopsychosocial approach. It integrates the biological, individual, and social dimensions of health. ICF uses three main domains. They are body functions and structures, activity and participation, and thirdly, environmental and personal factors. Those components interact with each other, and it's a feedback loop. The picture is to describe those domains I have mentioned here. Somebody is maintaining a normal health condition, and there are normal body functions and structures, and they perform various normal activities, and they participate in various life events. The environmental factors and personal factors can influence the health situation positively or negatively. If somebody has a health defect in the health condition or disorder or disease, the body functions and structures will have various impairments, and therefore the activity limitation and the participation restriction will result. The environmental factors and personal factors will influence the diseased health condition as well. So if we take stroke as an example, the impairments will be hemiparesis, expressive aphasia or receptive or global aphasia, impaired memory, impaired cognitive functions, incontinence or dysphagia. So the activity limitations may be inability to sit, to eat, drink, wash, bathe or to stand, and also will not be able to walk. So the participation restrictions will be things like they will have no independent functioning at home with family, there will be no social activities, will not ride a bicycle or drive a car, and if they have been the sole breadwinner, they will not be earning further. How the environmental factors are going to influence? If the individual is having steps in the front entrance, or if they have narrow entrances to the washroom or to the bedroom, they may not be able to use the walking frame or a wheelchair. And personal factors like lack of motivation or low self-esteem will also influence the level of independence of an individual. So this is how the ICF describes disability and functioning. And this is a standard and global or universal language in rehabilitation medicine. So ICF helps to classify the various impairment scales or disability assessment scales. So the three domains in the ICF are impairments, activity limitations, and participation restrictions. Assessment of impairment. So they have included the scales like the geriatric depression scale, the clock drawing test, and also this modified Ashworth scale, mini mental state examination. So they have been included in this assessment of scales which will assess impairment. The Canadian Neurological Scale, modified ranking scale, the National Institute of Health stroke scale, those are used to assess the stroke severity. This is the geriatric depression scale. It has 30 components, and the scores from 0 to 10 is normal, 10 to 20 is moderate depression, and 21 to 30 is severe depression. So the scores indicate the severity of depression, and it gives a rough idea how it is going to affect the functionality, it's a better guide for the medical intervention. So it's again will evaluate the severity of depression. Assessment of activity limitation. So activity limitation or activities here means naturally means the activities of daily living or the ADLs. The Bartel index, the familiar FIM score, functional independence measure, and also the 6 minutes minute walk test, timed up and go test, those are also included in this as activity limitation assessment scales. Familiar Bartel index is so these are activities of daily living, the essential ADLs, feeding oneself, bathing, grooming, and dressing. So the scores are given to the as according to the level of independence. If they are independent, they get 10 marks. If they need help, they get 5 marks. If they are unable to perform the feeding independently, they get 0 marks. And it's not only the ADLs, the mobility is also evaluated here. Mobility on level surfaces, stairs, so they are getting different levels of scores. The final score will be out of 100. So the Bartel index scores will give us a idea of the level of functionality or level of independence. So this can be repeated in during the course of rehabilitation, so that there will be a quantitative assessment or quantitative evidence of the improvement of the function. So it's a measure of functioning. There is no information about the medical diagnosis. This is generally used by stroke rehabilitation teams, but can be used in other rehabilitation centers having rehabilitating other physical disabilities. Assessment of participation restriction. So here they have included the scales measuring the health related quality of life. This the first page of the short form 36. It's a measure of global health related quality of life. The quality of life is defined here as the degree to which an individual is healthy, comfortable, and able to participate in or enjoy life events. So it's about participation in life events. So we should be able to select the best outcome measure or evaluation tool. The criteria recommended to guide your selection are reliability, validity, and responsiveness of each of those scales. Right, so that is about the available various severity or disability assessment scales, which is useful to quantify the disability and to measure the improvements in functionality during the rehabilitation course with the numerical value. In summary, all available outcome measures do not always fit neatly into a single category. They often assess elements belonging to more than one domain, so there are overlaps. And the other problem is only few studies have explored this post-stroke functionality based on the ICF conceptual model. Right. So any questions on that? Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Gunendrika. Thank you very much. Any questions, please? Anyone with questions? Everything had been very clear, Gunendrika.
Thank you, Anand.
Right.
It's a very short topic to discuss.
Yes, actually, initially we scheduled them as half an hour lectures.
Yes.
But then we made it half an hour to one another. So thank you very much for contribution, Gunendika. Thank you for all that who join. And please join for the final talk tomorrow at the same time. And then we will have the workshop on Friday and then finish off with it. Thank you for all that who join. See you tomorrow. Thank you.